is the Schaefer Baseball Report, an inside look at America's pastime. From Little League all the way to the big leagues. Now here's your host, former Major League infielder Jeff Schaefer.
Well, welcome everybody to the Schaefer Baseball Report number 65. And a lot of good topics today. We got back somewhat on task, didn't we, Andrew?
Somewhat.
Somewhat. Not bad. I don't think we could ever stay. I don't think we could do a show. We couldn't be news reporters.
No. We all have semi-orders of ADD.
So. Semi, yeah.
Semi. We're
is there a contest here? Who wins?
ADD?
Yeah.
You.
Yeah. What's John? ADC? And you're ADB?
ADCD.
ADCD? But yeah, we got another great show, and we appreciate everybody listening, and we'll be back right after these messages.
This segment of today's podcast is brought to you by EA Sports Fields. EA Sports Fields provides professional athletic field construction, design, renovation, and maintenance for all levels of play. Former professional groundskeeper for over 20 years, they provide a unique perspective regarding your playing surface. You've heard of the five tools of baseball? EA Sports Fields excels in the five tools of providing an exceptional playing surface for players, owners, groundskeepers, fans, and your community. To learn more about EA Sports Fields, find them on Facebook at EA Sports Fields Incorporated, or visit www.easportsfields.com.
All right, well, welcome everybody to the 65th Schaefer Baseball Report. And interesting week, as usual, in our youth travel showcase world and even in our high school world. So I got, everybody comes in and talks to us about stuff, you know. It's or we get phone calls like, you're not going to believe this. Or, you know, are we doing something wrong? And we got two different, what would you say they are? The way that you run a play, you know?
Just the fundamentals of the play.
The fundamentals of the play, the breakdown of the play. So we run a rundown. I think it's the same way it's been run for about 150 years. I don't think it's anything different where, you know, you catch the ball and you get the runner going and, you know, you dump the ball off and the guy calls ball, and then you move and you go behind the guy that you dumped the ball to, or you go to that base. And You follow your throw. But we heard, you know, that there's a new way to do it. And what you do is you get the ball and you get it out of your glove and you pump fake as many times as you possibly can. And then when you get rid of it, you quickly turn around and go back to where you started from. Brilliant, right?
I like it.
You know, changing the game again.
I like it.
So, I mean,
so pump fakes are in now, even though every coach I've ever said has been like, no on the pump fake.
No on the pump fake.
And then returning to your base, that makes total sense.
Oh, of course, yeah. Let the guy jump on your back and, you know, get a little interference on the way there. It's a safe place to go back to where you came from.
Oh, geez.
Exactly.
Yeah.
It's warm, it's fuzzy.
You know? I tell you what, cutoffs from the outfield and rundowns are probably my two favorite team activities.
Mm-hmm.
You get everybody moving, you get everybody, you know, there's a lot of different moving parts that are happening. At one time, they're probably two of the better places I think to go when you're, you know, trying to keep kids engaged and things like that, because there is so much that goes on. It's ridiculous to see how poorly they're taught.
Oh, and you know, we get it back because we see the execution of this stuff. And I mean, even, you know, to the extent of, you know, the showcase type kids that are going to the next level still don't know how to run. You know, those type of fundamentals. You know, it's important that, you know, you run, you know, when you're screaming trail, and they don't know what you mean, that's unfortunate.
And that's just the X's and O's. That doesn't even get into the technique work. You know, the cutoff man catching the ball with his
glove
with
side.
His feet moving, glove yeah. side, you yeah. know, turning his shoulders as the ball's in the air, reading, you know, making sure you have the right depth and so that you can read the runners that are, you know, on the base pass in front of you. And, you know, there's a lot of things that go into it that are, you know, when the kids think about them, it's like, okay, that's kind of common sense, but
sure.
You know, you got to go through it because there's so many different aspects to it. And then the rundowns, coming from the first baseman, you know, that's probably the most difficult one we see. The first baseman there's a ton of technique, not a ton of technique, but some basic things they got to understand as far as coming forward in front of the base path, creating a mm-hmm. throwing lane, getting the yeah. ball out of your glove, getting the guy yeah. moving, getting the shoulders turned on the base runner, and then, you know, delivering a ball and getting to your spot. But you see some of these guys that never, you know, were never really taught it, and they just, you know, they
lay up at night, they're laying in bed at night going, I got it, I figured it out.
I mean, I haven't looked for this online because this is something that was just drilled into me, you know, especially through spring trainings and stuff. But I mean, I feel like you got to be able to YouTube that before you go out and teach it.
You think you have some information there. There's plenty of information there. But, you know, this guy was brilliant. He's going to change the game. He's going to, you know. And it's just amazing. Like, and these are people, this is a high school coach. This isn't somebody that has, you know, you know, we work with kids all the time, and that's right. We work rundowns. We work in cutoff and relays all the time. What we do is our practices, we run the things that are going to happen most often in a game, right?
We need to make the routine plays.
Right. I mean, the routine plays should take your in and out. You run your cutoffs. You run your double cuts.
If you can get a little communication on the fly ball and pop-up priority stuff, that's always good. I mean, but it's all the, you know.
Bunt defenses. I mean, these are the basics of the game.
And the bunt defense is even getting into the weeds just a little bit. I mean, the other stuff is just routine. You're going to see that, you know, in just about every single ball game. The bunt defense takes a little more, it takes a little more work. And usually there's a little more on the line when that kind of comes up, you know. So it's not an every game kind of situation, but it's definitely something to touch on. But it's incredible.
All right, so here's
how poorly some of these things are.
It's just the knowledge, I guess, or you know, it's when you are a JV player and you almost made all league, but your coach screwed you. You know, this is what you remember from the game, and this is what you're teaching. So there's another play. Okay, so you run pickoffs. That's some that we work on also, right? You want to control the running game. You know, potentially get a kid that's a little froggy and you know pick him off. So you know we incorporate that into our practices. There's a new way to do it, though. So when there's a man on base and the pitcher has the ball, the coach from the umpire yells, fire! And then he turns and he throws to the base.
Why doesn't he just yell, why doesn't the guy in the third base coach yell balk simultaneously?
Huh? Yeah, there would be a defense to it, right? It would be a verbal defense. Man. You'd be like, yeah, brilliant.
And some of that, I mean, to me, that's... it's handcuffing your players, or it's I don't know. It's not, you're not allowing your players to go out there and perform. I mean, if you're yelling stuff across the field to initiate the play from the dugout,
that
I mean that's pretty
bush league.
That I wouldn't even call it bush league. I mean, it's just poor though, because you know it's like when you're watching kids on the base pass. You know, we're always verbal. You know, we're yelling. Right. We're go. You know, things like that. But there's nothing that replaces their first instinct. Like they're going to be quicker if they read it and they've if they've studied, if they know where the outfielders are at and they get the contact read. There's no way we're going to be faster. You know, ball in the dirt.
Right.
Kid pops up. If we yell go. And then he listens, he hears go, and then he goes. He's out.
In trouble.
He's out.
Yeah.
You know, so, you know, it's one of those things, like, if you're going to run, you know, successful pick plays at second base, it's got to be, you have to have players that have put the work in on the mound, that worked with the infielders, that have the timing mechanism down, that understand what they're trying to do, what they're looking for. You know, if you go in there and you try to take all the kids' thinking and get rid of all the instincts and stuff like that, it's going to be a slow, I mean, it's bad baseball. It's just going to be a slow, bad baseball game.
You know, we try to work on instincts, you know, but instincts sometimes are just some guys have it. You know, some guys have high baseball IQs. Some guys understand the anticipation of the game and go. So that's another thing that, you know, that we, you know, a man gets on third base, you know, what are you thinking? You know, a pass ball, right? Wild pitch, you're anticipating. So be aggressive, you know, because if it's a little bit out of the circle, you may be able to get it.
And then what are you looking for? What tells you if that ball is going to be in the dirt? You know, those are where the instincts come in.
Right.
This week with the 12U team, I was out of practice. And one of the things that we were focusing on wasn't anything crazy when you think about it, but it's just giving them knowledge before the pitch. It was coming up with a routine when they're on first base to make sure that they have all the information before they get out and get their lead. So it was making sure they were flashing the outs to the base coach, making sure that their next step after getting the sign was to check the outfielders to know where the outfielders were at, and then picking up the baseball and getting their lead. And it sounds really simple. It sounds, you know, it's everybody could do that. Everybody can do that,
but
not enough kids come off the base knowing where those outfielders are at. Yeah. And that's where good situational base running starts. You know, if you know where the fielders are, if you know that that line drive over the second baseman's head is into a gap now, it's not just a routine single, you're going first to third. You know, there's a lot of things that you can pick up, and you make a mediocre base runner a really good base runner, make a fast kid a great base runner. Mm-hmm.
So you have to play the game, but you have to play the game with people that, or for people that have knowledge of the game but understand how to teach. I'm not a big fan of the post game, let's have a meeting, powwow type of thing. I'm not. I'd much rather teach in the course of the game, you know, when the situation is hot and you stop them and you explain these things, you know. But I mean, there's many verbals that come out of the third base box or even the first base. So last perfect example, like last weekend, like, you know, I let John was coaching first for our team. John, okay, you're gonna handle the steals here. You know, you're gonna whisper in their ear. I'm not even gonna give a sign, you know, because I know his instincts and know what he's thinking. It's, you know, it's like, okay, and more times than not, we're on the same page and we would have run in the same situation. You know, but at least, you know, there's a group of people on the field that kind of understand that the game is played a certain way and there's certain pieces. You know, we were talking last week about the stopwatch, you know, and how important that is, you know. So you're saying, okay, we're looking for somebody that's, you know, a certain number to the plate.
So a right-handed pitcher that's in high school, if he's 1-3 or below, that's a pretty good number. If he's 1-3, 1-4, that's in the middle. You know, once you start getting into the 1-5 range, that's starting to get into the slower delivery time to the plate. And then if you add that to the pop time,
right?
So if you get if you get a kid that pops a 2, you know, and you put those two numbers together, you've got about a 3.5,
right?
3.5, 3.6, with a 12-foot lead. And a mediocre base runner, they have to get a great jump, and you're looking for a pitch. Now, if you take that same catcher and you put him at a 2-2, and you take that same pitcher and leave him at a 1-5, now he's at a 3-7, 3-8.
Right, we should now be walking into the second base.
Now we can steal on the fastball as long as we get the jump, you know, as long as we get the jump. So it's all just working the numbers together and understanding who's going. Another thing that I think the biggest thing that has helped me with steals, and Tom Haig, going back to Tom Haig Hoggins back several years ago, is – you know, I can just I sit there and I pattern pitchers. You know, I figure out, like, I had Tom Hayes stole 12 or 15 bags. And I mean, he's slow as molasses, right? He stole 12 or 15 bags over the summer, but and 12 or, you know, all 12 of them were on a breaking pitch. It's like, hey, we got a breaking ball coming here. You know, see you later. Go get your jump. Yeah. Get out there. So, you know, that on the pitching side, that's actually something that has helped me run the base pass, or help my guys on the base pass.
On the base running side, we've also taught our kids to peek. You know, I mean, so many of these catches at this age level just flash signs out there. I mean, if we wanted, you could call. I don't, because I want our guys to learn how to hit and work and recognize situations and counts. And, you know, I bet you at least twice a weekend we could sit there and go ahead and call pitches from the third base box or the first base box.
Yeah, just give verbals.
Just give verbals and stuff like that. But we don't, because I don't want, you know, I don't want our kids to do it. Now, if a kid gets out the second base and they're flashing one sign, or he's picking up, you know, second sign after, you know, whatever they determine their signs are going to be, and he can relay that to the hitter, I encourage that. Because those are players, you know, figuring out the situation. Those guys in tune to what's going on.
It's the pitcher and catcher's job to make sure that doesn't happen, too.
That's why we flash signs. Yeah. Yeah. You know, if you're just putting down a curveball or a changeup every time, I'm telling our guys, take off, run, go. You know, mm-hmm. You get banged, you get banged. But, you know, chances are you're not. There's so many of those little details in the game that, you know, that are not taught. You know,
and encouraged, even sometimes they're not even encouraged. It's, you know, it's knowledge. If you have knowledge, then you have confidence. If you have confidence, you're quicker, your instincts look better. You know, so anytime, you know, it goes back to, you know, looking at your outfielders. When you take your lead, if you take your lead, you know where that outfielder's at, you're faster. If you are on second base and you know a breaking ball is coming and there's one out and it's a good situation to take third base, you're going to be more aggressive. You're going to be a better player because of that.
So, I asked our dugout last week, you know, we were into the third inning. And, you know, we don't take in and out anymore like we did when we were playing, you know, early. And you can go out and sit and you can watch an outfielder's arm, right? So you got to determine who can throw, who can't throw. So in between innings, you watch these kids play catch. It's just like I'm watching the pitcher warm up. If I see a kid that's doing long toss and he's throwing darts from center field, I'm like, okay, you know, we got something coming, you know. But they don't watch. They don't pick up the information that can help them. And we have to kind of continuously relay it. Like, can that kid in left field throw a ball? No, okay, you're at second base and there's a ground ball right at him. What are we thinking? Are you looking for me, or are you going to, you know, are we going?
How cool is it? I will say this though. I mean, a lot of the kids aren't picking that stuff up, but then you get some of those guys that do pick it up.
Yeah.
And then, you see them out there and you see them just a step quicker on everything that happens. You know, Drew Roberts comes to mind with his base running. Like, I mean, he knew before the play happened how this thing was going to play out if this had happened. Yeah. And part of that, which I don't think happens enough, is the kids aren't rehearsing plays in their heads. They're not encouraged to rehearse plays in their head. I was talking to those guys about catching, when you see like a sports center catch in the gap, some outfielder goes 90 feet and lays out and catches the ball. That's not the first time he's made that catch.
Right.
He's made that catch 100 times in his head before that play happened. Mm-hmm. Those kind of guys that see the game that way and that are out there playing 2 and 3 games in their head, in addition to the physical game on the field, those guys have the edge, man. They absolutely have the edge. You see a kid out in the outfield and he's taking swings, or you see him going down and fielding, I mean, encourage that, man, because he's out there and he's imagining what's going to happen in this game.
So better to tame a stallion than to kick a mule, Let those guys be aggressive and go. It's just even details like secondary leads and things like that, or even taking a lead and not understanding like how much distance you really have. You're talking about time, right? I mean, watch these guys. How often do they go to first? How often do they turn and throw to second? Are they trying to slow down the running game? Are they not trying to slow down the running game? Take advantage of these things that have been given to you. I don't know where I developed those. I mean, I think I developed them in the street playing against my friends, at a young age, because we did it together. And then we figured out the game, that way. I didn't have these coaches that were saying, this is how you do, X, Y, and Z. You just go ahead and...
Well, you developed the aggressiveness, and then and then you hone that as the skill level that you're playing against picks up, mm-hmm. and you figure out how to pick your spots. But I think the instincts and stuff like that, they're not, some of it is, you're lucky to be a little quicker and stuff like that. But the instincts is from sitting there and having seen it before and being able to anticipate it.
So I went to Wilson STEM Academy this past week. And it is a Title I school, which means it's below the poverty line. And I got to speak along with Morris Madden and Alan Barnes, that are part of our Not Whole board. And the Wilson Academy is directly down the street from the complex we're building, right? So you had all these baseball fields here. I mean, literally, like, you could walk out the front door and walk 200 yards and be on our complex. And I spoke to the 8th grade that had 4 classes. And I asked those people, how many people have seen those fields being built down there? There was like 2. It was pretty sad. It was really sad, because that's been in their community. That Optimus Park has been in their community forever. Mm-hmm. And nobody's really, ever taken advantage of it. So it was wild. And then I'm asking them, and I guess this is probably just age, because they asked me like, tell us a little bit about your baseball career. And I had an opportunity to wear either a big league jersey there, or, that's what they expected me to wear. One of the 3 jerseys that I have. And I did it. I wore my college jersey just kind of like to give the impression of I had an education before I got to do what I got to do in the game.
And you got too fat.
And I couldn't fit in the other jerseys. Exactly. I couldn't fit in any other jersey. This one fit me. I was like, oh, okay. It actually made me look good. No, nothing makes me look good.
You didn't look as bad.
I didn't look at it as bad. Yeah, that's right. I didn't look at it as bad. So I asked the kids, how many of people know who Cal Ripken is? Not a single hand went up. These are 14, 15-year-old kids. Not a single hand, right? But you ask them who Snoop Dogg is.
Snoop Dogg? You're even dating yourself with Snoop
Dogg. Date myself with Snoop Dogg.
You gotta be like a little Nas X or...
Yeah. Who's Nas X? Is that like something like when you have a cold? He's like a mucus reducer or something?
He's on that Old Town Road.
Old Town Road. Drake.
Remember that one?
Oh, that video? I gotta find that video. I've been looking for that. That was like classic. That's classic. That video is too funny. Old Town Road is called? I'm searching
number
that.
One. It's the...
Dude, I don't listen to it.
That song was on
the
Billboard charts that broke the record for the longest number.
You know what I do? I podcast. I don't podcast. What is the Pandora when I go to the gym? And it's 70s and 80s rock. And that's about it. Some Van Morrison, maybe. Some Bruce Springsteen, things like that. I never... If you walk in the house, I sit on the couch and I watch Fox News from the minute I got in there to the time to go to bed. And then when I get in the truck, it's Fox News.
You? You're like my great-grandparents.
I am. That's all, man. That stuff plays out. There's no better daytime drama or nighttime drama going on than what's going on in politics.
Every day.
Yep. It's crazy.
I try to avoid politics like the plague. God, there's never anything good. No one's ever like, "Hey, we had a great deal happen today." Or, "Hey,
well, that's the Democrats."
Like, it's going both ways. No one's working together. They're just out there fighting all the time.
It's like, crazy. It is. They're all fighting for the election. But that's a whole different.
It's like the same story. It's like the same story every day.
No, it's not the same story every day.
So you're telling
me... One time it's Russia, then it's Ukraine, then it's...
I was going to say, all you have to insert is what different country you want to involve as far as who we're dealing with.
It's a cookie cutter thing. And then every now and then you get the predator out there that's chasing all his interns around. That's always interesting stuff. But it is. It's a revolver, isn't it?
I mean, it's the same. It's SSDD.
SSDD. What is
speaking of fights...
Same-ish... Different day.
Speaking of fights, how about the NL Central?
Yeah, that's gonna be tight. That's a good battle. What's the standings? 1.5 Cardinals.
Milwaukee won yesterday, and
the Cardinals didn't play.
So 3 games left for each of them.
So any combination of a Cardinal win and a Milwaukee loss, Cardinals take the
no. If they win all 3, they control their own destiny. Mm-hmm. Destiny.
Right.
If they win 2 out of 3, and Milwaukee sweeps, it's a tie.
Wow.
So
what happens at a tie?
They have to play the game.
The one game playoff.
And then the loser of that is likely to be wild card 2.
Right.
Which is the road game into Washington.
One game.
One game to face Scherzer.
I wish that was 3 games.
Hang with them.
I wish it went 3 games, 5 games.
Yeah, one game.
You just
tough.
Had 162 games. Go ahead.
So you're taking two games off of the division championship. So you go 3-game wild card, right? You played the whole season to play one game.
No, don't win the wild card then. Win the division.
I get it. But
that's why there's a premium on winning the division.
Okay, so but you still got to play the wild card.
Got to play the wild card game.
Okay,
and you could do the wild card game. Here's
so the wild card game beats them up, and it still gives the division series the division championship.
So here's the thing: if they tie, they have to play the play-in game.
Right.
Then they have to go play the wild card game.
Right.
You know, I mean, so you want to win the division.
Yeah. Sure.
You really want to win that division.
Mm-hmm. Okay, you guys don't want to hear my point.
No.
What's your point?
Totally ignore me.
I want to play a five-game series.
I mean, I want to play a 3-game series, okay, for the wild card. And then I want to play a 5-game series for the national, for the division championship. And then a 7-game for the World Series. So you're losing 2 in the division series. Right,
I mean it's the Brewers and Cardinals, so I don't have a ton of interest.
All right, so Schilt's mom's gonna come kill you because listen, I had lunch with her yesterday. The poor woman's in tears every day. She's like in pins and needles, and
No, they're in the playoffs. They're in the playoffs.
I don't consider the wild card the 1-game playoff. I don't consider that a playoff.
Then win the division.
Well, I get
That's
it.
On
but
you.
But
you
it's,
got lucky.
I, listen,
five, 7 years ago,
the
you
playoffs
were lucky
means
to even
you
get,
have a series. The playoffs is a series. The playoff, you know, it's a series.
They call it the wild card play-in game, don't they?
Do they call it a play-in game?
I don't know.
They're calling it a playoff berth.
Well, you know? I mean, it's a postseason berth.
It's a postseason
it's
berth
game. Yeah. I don't know. I mean, I don't discount the. You don't want to discount the division for sure. I mean, we all agree
right.
on that.
Right.
And then it all becomes like, how do you fit all this stuff in there? Like, do you want to shorten the division series? Or would we rather have that series be a stronger series? And the wild cards is what it is. You know, I feel like that's the lesser of the two evils right now. I'd rather have the wild cards have to fight for it with
like,
the division
I,
winners.
I do like the wild card, but I don't like the format. That's my gig.
We could, with your series is set up, we're going to play into December.
What's wrong with that? You got a problem with that?
Everything's in a dome.
Huh?
How about the Twins hitting 300 home runs?
Oh my gosh,
that's nuts!
Name 3 Twins players.
Shoot, I don't know Twins players.
I tell you, Sano is one.
Sano.
I like Sano.
You got Cruz. You got Sano.
Okay. Tomato. Yeah, Sano.
Yeah, I don't pay attention to the Twins.
No, he's strict with Cardinals. Yeah. Step it up, dude.
Sorry.
Yeah. I couldn't name another player on the team. I'm going to throw out Martinez because there's a Martinez on every team.
God, you're racist.
It's one in every team.
Racist.
Right? It's like Smith.
How many players do they have with over 30 home runs?
43.
On total.
You're playing up there, too. And, I mean, it's not like April and May the ball is flying in Minnesota.
Right.
Mm-hmm. And then, you got a roster, outside of Cruz and Sano, you can't name anybody on this team. And everybody's got 25, 30 home runs.
Yeah.
It's a joke.
Yes, it is. The oppo's a joke. That's, to me, that's the determining factor. It's not how far the guys are pulling the ball. Mm-hmm. It's these guys that are just flicking line drives out of right field from the right side. But, all right, so listen to this statistic. Okay, and this is, we're going to move into the knothole and the complex and everything. We're close. The second field is almost complete. Fences are up and everything's almost done on field one.
More importantly, though, I made an amazing spreadsheet yesterday.
You did make an amazing spreadsheet yesterday. Color coordinated. It fit my... My visual processing.
Eddie over at EA or me making a spreadsheet. What is more impressive? Me making a spreadsheet. Color coding it. It's pretty impressive. Like, I mean, anybody.
What did he do?
Building fields.
Oh. I thought you were talking about him.
Irrigation systems.
I thought you were saying him making a spreadsheet. No. I'm like, Eddie making a spreadsheet's pretty good.
Yeah. The biggest hurdle with me making the spreadsheet is honestly trying to figure
staying
out.
Staying awake.
Trying to figure out what the login is to get on the computer. Like, it's, it's got I don't even have my own computer. It's Grady's computer.
Dude.
I had to figure out.
This is what we're hiring.
I had to figure out what his passcode was. And it was almost over. Yeah, it was almost over.
You stressed on that one.
Conditional formatting and all that stuff?
Yeah.
He did none of that.
So he just highlighted the color.
He figured out just today with crayon.
Yeah, are you
with crayon?
This thing, you can't draw on it with a Sharpie.
No, Trump would.
Yeah, he would.
Yeah. Oh, beautiful. Andrew, how many times do I call you for passwords and stuff like that? I'm like the worst with that, too.
Yeah, you are. You have my own 15 passwords. Sticky notes on your computer.
I do. I got to go through every
sticky note. That thing's like Fort Knox.
Yeah, it's safe. Nobody can come in here and get into my stuff. It's all over the place.
Everybody can, but you.
I can't remember anything, man. It's unbelievable. And then so we had to, I had to fill out a form for Dylan to go on. Dylan's in dance, right? It's one of those things.
Of course.
He loves it.
Of course.
Loves it. And so they're going to go down to Winthrop on this field trip. And I got to print out the form and fill out the form. And Amanda's got to write the check. And we put it on the counter. And, it's like, Dylan, don't forget your stuff and the check and everything this morning. I was like, yeah, I got it, Dad. I'm good, right? 2 minutes out the door, they drive to school together. 2 minutes out the door. Hey, Dad. Can you bring that form by school? I'm like, this kid is all me. Because if it was Zach would have had it, not only that, it would have been in an envelope with somebody's name on it.
In his briefcase.
Yeah, and there'd be like a backup plan, like a stamp on it in case I forget. Mail this, hurry up. Two different kids. But yeah, I forget a lot of stuff, man. Especially passwords. So that's the running joke around here.
All right, what's your stat?
Okay, here's my statistic, or this is what I read this morning. Only 20% of the children from homes with incomes under $25,000 a year play sports, compared to 45.5% of kids from homes with an income greater than $100,000 a year. Pretty crazy.
Mm-hmm.
Goes back to exactly what we're doing with our nonprofits. Goes back to what we're doing with UDACF and Knothole and Morris up there with the RBI program, is that... It all comes down to the economics. It doesn't come down to every kid needs participation. It comes down to every family needs to be able to afford to pay for the kid to play.
Yeah, it's not. That didn't even mention baseball specifically.
That's no, just it's all sports in general, sports. Right? So it could be.
But I mean, that's yeah. I mean, it's always economics. It's all, you want to talk about kids' diets, organic food and non-organic food. Right. It would probably be something very similar to that. Like,
sure.
Only 5% of people under $25,000 a year eat organic food or whatever the case may be. I mean, money makes the world go round. We've got to find a way to bridge the gap. Especially, I mean, here's the thing: like, if kids don't play sports when they're young, they're not going to play sports mm-hmm. later on. It's not something you pick up
right.
So, I mean, with sports in particular, kids can change their diet as they get older and they become their own individuals, but as kids, we have a responsibility as a society to make sure that we're exposing them to it and getting them the opportunity. And I'm not even talking about the kids that are you know, college bound and all that. No, just getting out there and learning how to perform within a team and how to, you know, how to manage yourself, learning how to have some of those qualities.
Yeah. A lot of these kids in that school that I went through the other day. I mean, so I asked them, I said, what's your dreams? I mean, cause I always kind of like table things like, okay, everybody has dreams, right? So dreams are like, we dreamt of playing in the big leagues. Okay. You dream that when you're 10, 11, 12 years old. Doesn't mean you're going to the big leagues just because you dream it. You have to set goals along the way. And how do you get there? Well, these kids all had dreams. None of them understood how to set goals. You know, like, what do you need to do? And I was telling one kid, I said, okay, what's your dream? He goes, I want to be in the military. I'm like, okay, do you understand? You know, where? Army. Okay. Do you know about West Point? No, what's West Point? You know, well, go West Point. Why don't you go in as an officer? Why don't you figure out if you have the ability to? And I said, you're sitting in a poverty situation, you know, where they're going to encourage you to be, you know, and give you a greater opportunity to get something like that, because it's, you know, there's minority opportunities involved in it, and lower income opportunities involved in it. And so I said, how many kids have phones? And they all raise their hand. I said, how many kids Google? That group right there. I didn't Google. You know, they didn't go. I'm like, you have, you know, we had to go get like encyclopedias and stuff like that and figure it out.
Nah, just make it up.
Yeah. As long as it sounds good, you make it up, right? But none of the kids got it. I mean, so I'm like, you know, go figure out, like, what are the steps? You know, go down and meet, you know, can you be in the ROTC? You know, what are your grades needed to be? What are the options? You know, what are the branches? And it was wild. So then I had a whole group, right? Out of the whole group, there's probably, I probably saw 80 kids, maybe. Maybe that's a little high, 70, 60. I asked, how many of you guys want to be teachers?
None.
Two. Mm. Two raised their hand. Pretty sad.
Mm-hmm.
Pretty sad scenario. But to go back to that, the situation and what we're involved with, and with Knot Hole and UDACF, and we have our gala coming up on November 8th, which is a good time. And it's, you know, it's baseball people in the community that, you know, they're not territorial. They could care less who they play for, what they do. And they show up, and we have a big party, and we raise funds to help players into our environment or other environments that are going to give them the opportunity. To your point, John, the opportunity is not just, you know, are we going to the next level as a college baseball player, or are you going to be a pro? You know, it's education first. You know, can you get the opportunity? Because these kids are getting boxed out if they can't be in there to go to a showcase or to get into a venue or a tournament where there's going to be college recruiters there. They're going to give them an opportunity to lessen the blow of going to college financially. Health and wellness is a big part of what we're doing out there. We have an agreement with Atrium that's going to bring their, you know, their traveling mobile, you know, unit out, and you know, they're going to get physicals, and then we have, you know, the kids are going to come get their teeth checked out, and then just being out there, just, you know, life skills and lessons. But, you know, it's funny because the looks on the kids at that grade in that situation would be different if you were looking at a kid down in South Charlotte. No, it's just their eyes are different. You know, it's almost like they this is what it is, and there's not much hope to it. Mm-hmm. You know, and how do we give that back to them? So, you know, the gala is on November 8th. You know, we have tickets for sale at udacf.org. I mean, go. It's a great night. There's a lot of auction items. It's an open bar. We have dinner. We've had some great guests in the past. You know, we've every year we've had a great guest, no doubt about it. Tom Walter from Wake Forest, who donated his kidney to an incoming, or do you donate your whole kidney? Yeah, you got two of them, right? Yeah, you donate your whole kidney. Is this meat or is this venison?
That? It's cannibalism, if you will. Don't eat that.
Next year we had Chris Singleton, whose mom was the Sharonda, who was the pastor at the Charleston Church Massacre. Year after that, Landon Powell and his wife Allison. You know, just this game is, you know, been his sanctuary, and also, you know, he's mentoring young men down in North Greenville, changing lives down there. Mike Schilt, head coach, manager of the St. Louis Cardinals. And this year we have Jack Leggett. And Jack is the manager of our 18U USA national team and a lifetime of coaching at the college level, and the majority of it at Clemson University. So,
do you think he's going to be on board with a new way to do rundowns?
Oh yeah.
He's listening right now. Yeah, sure, he's all over this. Yeah, he's probably. We'll see our national team, you know, pump faking and running back to their spot where they're safe. Head home. So, you know, that's it. And then we built the complex. You know, and the complex has programming to it that's not everything that's done is not going to be for the dollar amount. We're going to create opportunities for those kids up in that area that can come out there and participate and hopefully get involved in our game. So there's another statistic out that says baseball, as far as percentages since 2015, is increasing. And basketball is number one, baseball, but then football and soccer are decreasing.
I saw football. It was kind of a dual football. Tackle football is decreasing, and flag football.
What ages was that, Schaefer? You remember?
Youth, more the little league level.
Yeah, I can definitely see that. Yeah, I can see that.
You can see on the smaller fields.
Yeah. You know what's that's great. It's a great stat. We need more fields. There's not enough fields out there to take all these kids into account.
The last number that I saw, we'll talk 60-90 because that's what I know. But a lot of the rec organizations, we don't have enough of them, or the ones we do aren't being properly run. But there was, for every 128 teams that play on a 60-foot mound, 90-foot base field, there was only one field available.
That seems amazing. And you know what bothers me about that number? And I don't know if the number's perfect or not.
No, it's not perfect.
It's definitely close. You get these schools. Yeah, exactly. I would have said something in a thousand. You get these public schools.
Right.
It's the community, right? It's the community school. And you can't get any field time at their fields.
Well, you can get it. You can get it at
I'm not talking about every
Advance,
field.
And you can get it at Waddell, and you can get it at, we had to scratch. McDowell did a great job scratching over here, like I said, at Waddell. But Olympic, schools like that where the school districts.
Well, they don't care about baseball at all.
No. They don't care about the fields. They may think that they care about baseball, but they don't care about maintaining the fields.
I get it because, these coaches put a lot of time and energy and their own blood and sweat into these fields. And they look great, and they sit dormant a lot of the time. Yeah. And there's a lot of teams.
Why they look great in those areas, right there?
They got money.
Yeah, they have booster clubs. Mm-hmm. They got higher than $100,000 a year incomes in those areas. So you go to the other places, and you get up to Vance and Lendl Porter, and you're going to say, "Hey, let's have a booster club." What are you boosting? What are you going to bring? Mm-hmm. They're worried about eating. Mm-hmm. They're not worried about how nice is this field and are we the top? But you go down to AK, where Bags does a great job. Bagwell does a tremendous job on that field. It's beautiful. Mm-hmm. But, it's built and used for whatever program he wants to build and use it for, which is his collegiate program or his high school fall program or whatever. But again, he has the money, he has the resources coming. Not only, they probably get a little bit more money in that school district than they do, the other ones, but he's got a booster club money.
You can look where the good baseball teams come out of consistently, and you can guarantee that the average income is higher.
Oh, no doubt about it. Yeah, I mean, listen, it's what we do in here.
Providence, Myers Park, Hardrickell. I mean, those are schools in our area. What's the school up on the north side of town? Huff.
Yeah. Mooresville. You get up in there.
You've got to have some money to play this game, and that's what the foundation is trying to bridge.
Look at Olympic, for example, right? Their football field's turf, and they have, huge stadium seating there.
It's revenue.
Yeah, I mean, you look at their baseball field, it's bad. Yeah. It used to be okay. It used to be feasible when I was there, but...
I'll tell you what, I've been over there. It's a good piece
of... bones.
It's a good piece of property. You could do... The way it's set up and the areas around it that you could transition and stuff, I mean, there's a lot of opportunity there. Mm-hmm. Again, it's going to come down to... what kind of money can come into that program?
Right.
What can be boosted?
Well, when I was there, Eddie redid the field. It's just not maintained. No one maintains it.
When you were there, Eddie redid Olympic. Mm-hmm. Well, that's what people don't understand is the maintenance. I mean, we're watching that. We're watching that complex be developed, and it's to major league specs. And there's 8-inch ravines in every part of that field, deep, 8-inch deep, 10 feet wide, just for drainage. So when you go ahead and you build something like that and you put the investment into it like Eddie did over there, if you don't maintain it, it's grass. It's gonna turn to weed. It's gonna there's dust.
You gotta keep putting dirt into it and stuff.
Waddell has a garden hose that goes out to the field to water the infield dirt. I mean, Jack McDowell's been out there for an hour and a half watering the field because it's so dry that it just keeps sucking it up. And he's got a water hose. I mean, it's crazy. You watered Springfield the other day, which we maintain, you know, and how fast does that water evaporate? And we've soaked that field many times. So there's water, you know, underneath the dirt.
Right. Yeah, you got to saturate it.
Yeah. But it's, you know, it's fortunate because, you know, you got a chance to go and they turn the lights on and you got a nice hardwood floor and you got a basketball court and, you know, it's nice. Like, I've never really been in a basketball court that I go, well, this is just absolutely horrible, unless the floors are all warped or something.
That was, you know, my high school.
That was your high school?
Well, my high school. So I went to high school in the San Fernando Valley and the Northridge earthquake had happened in 94. Yeah. So I went into high school in 94, you know, the end of 94, right. 95 was my freshman year. And the gym was condemned for the first bit. Like, it wasn't even open. There was a auxiliary gym that they had to practice in, and then after a while they opened it back up. It was structurally sound, but it was literally that floor. Like, there was slats missing.
Yeah, man.
We were in there playing some,
but you were hooping
basketball.
You were hooping.
I was the Great White Hope.
Were you? You were the Jerry Cooney of basketball.
I don't know what that means, man.
Jerry Cooney, man. He was the Great White Hope off of Long Island. Yeah, yeah.
Never heard of.
Got pounded by Ali. Got pounded by Frazier.
Oh, they probably made a story.
Big Irish guy that, you know.
Oh, I saw he's a beer delivery guy now. He's
in the Suffolk County Hall of Fame. I'm in there.
Not a you know, maybe this guy's from Boston.
No,
I'm thinking about the guy from Boston. But this guy got he got beat up pretty good.
Yeah.
But now he's a beer.
Carmine Pasilio. That's that was, he was like some beer guy out of. It's interesting, but. You know, the fields have to be maintained. You know, I mean, I've learned that from Virginia when we had Virginia, how, you know, you play on these fields your whole life and you have no idea what it takes or, you know, what it takes to build it. Number one, the cost, the labor that's involved. We went out and we did the sod that day. That's, that's some manual labor, man. That's a bear. And then to maintain it, to keep it the way it is and keep the surface playing the way that you want it to play. Because, you know, what we took over at the Optimist Club was completely run over. You know, it was.
And that's, you know, I mean, even the rec leagues that are in pretty good shape, I mean, that's what happens with the fields. I mean, they're, you know, it's, they drag it and they mow the lawn. There's no like long-term work put into them. Every, you know.
Schedule of aeration and
that's
and
why
seeding
the
Springfield and sanding
is unbelievable.
Yeah.
I mean, the infield plays smooth.
Yep.
The grass is, you know, the grass is tight where it's supposed to be. The mound is the right distance from home plate, which is another funny thing you see.
And
these
the mound is lined up with second base.
If you go measure these mounds out at some of these fields, you'd be like, wow, first of all, we're a foot left and we're throwing 59 feet. So,
have you been over to Indian Land? Mm-mm. Have you been over to Indian Land? Mm-mm. That mound is a mountain, right? Literally a mountain. You know, I've walked up to go get it, and I feel like I'm hiking up something. Trace White told me the other day they raised the mound. I'm like, how do you raise the mound? You're going to get like snow caps up there if you go in freaking higher. It's brutal.
It creates its own weather
It's
system.
Brutal. But, you know, we built that facility right in the heart of 10 D1 Title I schools, which are all below the poverty line. So we'll do some programming. To bring some of those kids out and get them engaged in the game, and hopefully
March 27th for sure.
You know,
That's a date. March 27th. Yep. We'll be doing something.
Yep. So we'll do some programming with MLB as well, the play ball and different things like that. But, you know, that's where we're at. That's where our energies are at. You know, I mean, we love doing the teams and it's a big part of it. And we love talking the strategy of the game and being involved in it and competing every day. But, you know, in the end, this is, I don't know, nobody's trying to create a legacy, but legacies happen, you know, and this is something that you want to leave behind and make sure it's special. Anything else on your weekend to get your boys playing?
Yeah, they're playing. They both play Sunday.
Yeah.
So chasing around the little guys. I think they're just local deals. And then going to see a friend of ours. She's a comedian.
Oh.
So I'm going to some comedian festival. I don't even know what they're called.
Don't sit in the front row. You will get abused. Like, sit in the back in the dark and don't let them even... Unless you think you're that guy that can banter with a comedian. I don't think I have the... I couldn't do it.
I could do anything I want if I had 12 Coors Lights in me.
That's true, too. You're a pretty funny dude. Andrew's related to a comedian.
Mm-hmm. Andrew's cousin. Sebastian Maniscalco.
Oh.
That guy's funny, man. Mm. You don't like that guy?
Oh, I can't stand him.
I love that guy.
I was at the Chipotle.
And then you got to go like this. Then you got to go like...
He's from like Illinois, and he sounds like he's like the biggest jabroni.
He's like his like first cousin.
Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sure he's a really nice guy, but I can't stand him. He just did the
How about Bill Barr?
He did Bill Burr. Bill Burr's the best.
Right. Bill Barr's hilarious too. He's on,
was it the MTV Music Awards he did recently or something?
Yeah, the VMAs. Yes.
He hosted them or whatever. Oh, that was uncomfortable. I watched. I didn't watch. It was just like a little highlight of the beginning. It was just like.
Did you see the Bill Burr thing when he was in Philadelphia? Have you seen it?
I no.
Oh my God, he just talking about sitting in the front row and he just went off. He had 10 minutes to be on stage. 14 minutes, I think it was. 14 minutes to be on stage, and he said, "For the next 14 minutes, I'm just gonna rip everything about Philadelphia. It's unreal."
Yeah.
Yeah, it was, I mean, just to like pull that off and go, but, all right, well, Andrew's giving us the, let's get out of here. I got to head down to Charleston. Charleston, South Carolina, and we're going to play down at the Shipyard the first time. It's supposed to be a pretty special place, too. Again, dollars to go, dollars to play. Here we go. But we appreciate everybody listening to number 65, and look forward to talking to you sometime next week. So peace out.